Hello and welcome to the show. My name is Apingo and I'm Dad, Chinese History Guy. Here, we share the stories from the myths, legends and histories of the Chinese people, from the first creator to the last imperial dynasty. More than 6,000 years of stories, one video at a time. And if you like content like this, remember to like, sub, comment and share. Now, we've mentioned a few times before that no great deeds were ever accomplished by a single person. It always took a team or at least a very capable assistant. So in this episode of the Shang Dynasty, we are going to talk about the slave that was elevated to the position of the Grand Councillor of the Shang court and was recognized by future generations as the first sage of the Chinese people, hundreds of years before even Confucius was born. And of course, we will also take a quick look at the written record of his interactions with the king that he served faithfully throughout his life. Now, after E15, who was the Grand Councillor and Chief Assistant to King Shang Tang that built and founded the Shang Dynasty, I guess the most famous official of the Shang court has to be Fu Yue, who was the Grand Councillor in King Wu Ting's court and was also the chief architect of King Wu Ting's route to success in creating the golden age of the Shang dynasty. Now, Fu Yue was born as a commoner in a place called Dacheng, which is in today's Shanxi Dacheng village, and was known to be an extremely intelligent person. Now, in his younger days, he lived in a cave near Dacheng known as Fu Yan, with little to almost no contact with people. Now, his cave dwelling was actually located among the high mountains near the border between the fiefdoms of Yu and Hu. And a stream ran past the cave opening, and during rain seasons where, you know, there was heavy rainfall, these rain waters will fill the stream up and actually flood the roads that ran, you know, below it. And therefore, a sizable team of slaves was always garrisoned there or stationed there in the area to build mud walls to block the floodwaters and to repair the roads whenever they were flooded. Now, however, these mud walls, as we know, were not very effective at containing water, so they will be washed away, you know, by the heavy rainfall, and the work was basically never ending, you know, requiring new mud walls to be built after every heavy downpour, and the roads would have to be constantly repaired because they will be always flooded and destroyed by the flood waters and the rain waters. Now, after observing this phenomena and this series of events over a period of time, Fu Yue decided to, you know, help these slaves out, you know, make their lives easier. And what he did was that he innovated a new way to build these walls, these flood walls that could actually withstand the onslaught of these flood waters. So what he did was that he came up with this idea to fill up these wooden frames. He built wooden frames and he placed them beside the road, and he filled these frames up with a mixture of mud, clay, fibers and small rocks and stones that were scavenged from around the area. And then, using these heavy wooden stems, he would compact the contents inside these frames to create an impenetrable wall of rammed earth. So yes, he innovated a method to make rammed earth walls that is, you know, used in making very big sections or very large sections of the Great Wall of China in later days. Now, this innovation greatly improved the quality of the flood walls and simplified the slaves' work. And it actually garnered Fu Yue much praise and applause from the people around the area. I mean, especially amongst the hardworking and very oppressed slaves. However, it also triggered the jealousy of the nobility and the slave owners, and therefore what happened was that the nobilities and the wealthy slave owners and landowners accused Fu Yue of some made-up crime and actually made him a slave to work on the roads and the war details in the area. Oh yeah, so you like working on roads, you like working on wars, right? Okay, we'll make you a slave and you can work on the roads and the wars all you want. Yeah, jealousy, abuse of power, oppression. Yeah, throw in whatever term you like here. That's what happened. Now, it was very possible and in fact very probable that King Wu Ting actually knew Fu Yue during his time living as a commoner amongst the populace. And he was greatly impressed by Fu Yue's intelligence and his spirit of innovation. And through the many conversations that they had as young men, Fu Yue showed that he not only had a very bright engineering mind, he also possessed a very sharp political instinct and had his own views on politics and governance. And so when Wu Ting returned to the capital to take over the throne after his father passed away, he never forgot about this talented slave that he met, you know, when he was living as a commoner. He was convinced that Fu Yue would be a great asset in helping him achieve the goal of restoring the glory of Shang. There was just a small problem. He needed to, you know, figure out a way to break this very strict social taboo to raise Fu Yue beyond his station and status as a slave. And as it happens, we all know that the Shang people were actually an extremely superstitious lot, and they had great respect for the heavens, and they were staunch believers in, you know, the spirits of the land and the spirits of ancestors, you know, all those spiritual stuff. And, you know, oracles and omens would influence almost every aspect of their lives. And so King Wu Ting seized upon this trait of the Shang people and Shang beliefs to plot the elevation of Fu Yue. So one night at the end of the 3 years of silence, King Wu Ting suddenly woke up one night laughing hysterically and loudly, and it alarmed all the, you know, palace servants who were worried that the king has finally, you know, lost his mind. I mean, after 3 years of staying silent in court and not saying anything, you suddenly, you know, laugh hysterically in the middle of the night. I guess most people would think, like, you know, the king has finally, you know, lost his mind, he is finally off his rockers, man. And so all of them came rushing into the palace and to check on him, to see if he was alright. And it was then that Wu Ting, you know, proclaimed loudly through tears of joy, you know, and he proclaimed that, you know, there is hope for the Shang, we shall finally reclaim our glory. The late king has came to me in my dreams and told me of a man named Yue, you know, and he shall aid me in bringing forth a golden age for the dynasty. Go, find him, spare no resources in bringing this man before me. And immediately after, you know, this prophecy or this proclamation, King Wu Ting then described Fu Yue's appearance to the court artists and have them make portraits for his people to, you know, recognize him and to seek him out from amongst the people. Now, before long, of course, the king's men found Fu Yue and brought him to court, and King Wu Ting immediately, on the spot, freed him from the status of slave and elevated him to the position of Grand Councillor of the Shang court, of his court. While the nobles and the officials of the court were pretty much, I mean, you can guess they will be pretty much disgruntled and unhappy. A slave elevated above us as Grand Councillor. What the, you know? But, you know, they have to swallow it and accept the decision because it was a recommendation made directly by the spirit of the late king. So yeah, suck it up, guys, you have to accept that. Yeah. And I mean, true to his form, Fu Yue also did not disappoint King Wu Ting. He used 4 guiding principles in implementing policies and guiding the direction of the kingdom's development. Number one, he proposed a harsh punishment to quell the chaos of the land. Number two, to guide the populace to be in awe of the heavens and authority. And number three, to recruit talents based on capability and merit, regardless of status and regardless of bloodline. And number four, to educate the people and deliver them from ignorance. Now, under these guiding principles and with King Wuting's resolute support behind him, Fu Yue was actually able to grow the kingdom's economy. He was able to clear up the political landscape of the Shang court and reform the culture of the people and society during King Wuting's reign. Now, regarding Fu Yue's interactions with King Wuting after his elevation to Grand Councillor, they were actually recorded in three chapters within Shang Shu, which were the three chapters were named Yue Ming, parts 1, 2, and 3. Now, in Yue Ming part 1, it was actually the first conversation between King Wuting and Fu Yue after he was elevated to the status of Grand Councillor, and it was a conversation where King Wuting ordered Fu Yue to hold nothing back in providing his advice and counsel to him. He equated Fu Yue's advice to a urgently needed heavy dose of medication that is needed to treat a severe illness, and if the medication was not strong enough, it would not be sufficient to reverse the predicament that the kingdom has found itself in. And to which Fu Yue replied that a king who is open to receiving criticism and suggestions will no doubt be a wise king, and he would offer his best advice to a wise king even if he were not ordered to do so, and therefore he would do his best to obey this order that was given to him to hold nothing back in providing counsel. Now, in Yue Ming part 2, Fu Yue discussed with King Wuting his theories and his methods regarding politics and governance. He explained the importance of having a clear chain of command from the central court to the local leaders, the local regional leaders of the realm, and orders issued should be quickly and accurately implemented, even if it was to be delivered to the edges of the realm. Now, that was only possible if diligent and conscientious officials were appointed that were based on merits instead of bloodline or their status in society or even nepotism. So, you know, he kind of put forth the point that, you know, merits and capability should be prioritized over social status and position. And also, Fu Yue told the king that royal orders should only be issued after careful considerations of the all possible impacts that it might create. And once issued, they should not be lightly altered or changed. And this will ensure that all directives from the court will be taken seriously and acted upon with all urgency. Now, further discussions that were documented in Yue Ming Part 2 covered these topics of efficiently deploying the resources of the kingdom, you know, and making sure that the kingdom is always prepared before making any major moves or any major decisions. And most importantly, Fu Yue told the king or advised the king on the importance of remaining humble and being vigilant against complacency, because complacency is always the beginning of the downfall of even the mightiest of kingdoms and dynasties. And after hearing this speech and having this conversation, King Wuting was greatly impressed, and he exclaimed that Fu Yue's words have given him a very clear direction to move towards. And it was at this point that Fu Yue, you know, replied with the famous phrase that would, you know, cement his position as being recognized as the first sage in Chinese history. What he told King Wuting at this time was, "Understanding is easy, but execution is hard." Now, it is a very, you know, simple statement, but it is a statement that rings true even today, more than 3,000 years after it was uttered. And so yeah, it is timeless wisdom. Understanding is easy, execution is hard. And finally, we come to Yuanming 3, where King Wuting expressed his wish for Fu Yue to be as great a pillar of the kingdom as Yin was during King Shang Tang's time, to which Fu Yue also expressed his desire for King Wuting to be as great and wise a king as King Shang Tang himself. Now, both of them agreed that it was nearly impossible for any king, no matter how great, to accomplish great deeds without the assistance of able counselors and a good team. And it was also impossible for a great talent to shine without the recognition of a wise ruler. Now, the strong bond between the sovereign and his servant was one of the major cornerstones and catalysts that enabled this duo, this partnership, to bring about the golden age of the Shang Dynasty. And the relationship between King Wuting and Fu Yue was also used, you know, and referenced extensively through subsequent dynasties throughout the years. They were used as a shining example of good partnership and good relationship between sovereign and servant. Now, later scholars and poets and writers throughout the ages will compose odes, verses, poems to exalt the virtues and the talents of Fu Yue, who was recognized as the first sage of the Chinese people hundreds of years before Confucius was even born. Now, I hope you enjoyed this story as much as I enjoyed telling it. And if you did, please remember to like, sub, comment, and share. And if you would like to, you know, support the channel in more substantial ways, you could do so through Patreon. The links are available in the description box below. It would really, really help to keep the lights on around here. And so, thank you very much in advance if you are, you know, subscribing to Patreon. And I guess that's it for today, and I will see you in the next episode.